Well, hello there. It's time for Star Wars, Episode 4, A New Hope, 9M2, The Swashbucklers, music by John Williams, orchestrated by Arthur Morton. And this is about the fourth time I've recorded this. I was trying to do it with OBS and my video camera, and it just went so badly out of sync by the end. I don't know what's happened. Sometimes it does that, sometimes it doesn't, which is why I just can't keep doing it again. I've spent 2.5 hours so far, and have to abandon each one, so I'm just going to do it without video because I don't have time to do it. I've got other stuff I need to be doing. Anyway, there we go. So orchestrated Arthur Morton, not Herb Spencer, this particular one. I will be saying everything that I've just said to myself all over again. Never mind. This is one of the things of doing YouTube stuff, is that you kind of sometimes get so far and then have to abandon and go all the way back and do the same thing again. But hopefully it gets better each time. Anyway, I don't know why I'm explaining this to you. You don't need to know, but there we go. So what an incredible cue. This is pretty much the heart and soul of Star Wars, really, in so many different ways. We've got sort of two parts of it, really, the sort of ostinato-y Imperials section, and then we've got the heroic main title, or Luke's theme, really, which appears as well, a little bit of Leia coming in as well, just here at that point on page 10. And then you'll see that I've kind of tried to keep it as orchestral as possible, partly because it's quite awkward to show absolutely what everything's doing, because I wanted to make sure that if what people want to do mock-ups of this, then it's a bit easier to kind of do it yourself with a score that doesn't really, you know, it's not easily obtainable, so hopefully it will sort of show you how that works. And of course, if you're a patron, you can just sort of have all of this for a small monthly fee. Anyway, the Swashbucklers. So we're starting off with an interesting situation where we've got this chord here. I'm going to go quite slowly for some of this. So we've got B flat, D flat, and F. And then we've got a sharp 4 or a flat 5. So the B flat minor bit is in second inversion. And then we put that sort of sharp 4 in the bass. So we get this really nice sort of smudging effect. And it's part of a Hungarian minor subset. Interesting enough, it's also got an A in the bass as well, so it's even more interesting. because it actually has an extra major seventh on it, which creates set 522 for those sort of set theory people. Like that. And even the F sharp as well is also part of this Hungarian minor. So this is the Hungarian minor scale. Exactly the same as a harmonic minor, but with the fourth is raised by a semitone. So that's what it is. So we're in B flat minor territory, but we also have an interesting thing here as well, because the Imperials theme is actually in C minor. Like that. And to combine with the timpani as well, we get a sort of another axis point. So there are almost two tonalities going on at the same time. This sort of B flat Hungarian minor, but also the C minor theme with its timpani accompaniment as well. We get a sort of really interesting effect. So I'm going to play that for you. And I've just realised that that is in the wrong pace as well. So occasionally mistakes happen, everybody. Sort of really interesting and very, very strong, sort of almost violent type of sound at that point. Very sort of redolent of Stravinsky at that point. And, you know, offbeat as well, but with things which are on the beat, on the beginning of the bar as well, which is interesting. But notice that the other hard hits actually come on the second beat of the bar, which is in three. We don't really get a sense of, you know, is it in three or four at this point. I'm going to play it once more. Yeah, this sort of arrhythmic effect. So, and then suddenly we've got trumpets and trombones with this little modular section of two bars. So isn't it interesting that the notes that he starts with are C and B flat, precisely the same two tonalities that we had right at the beginning, C minor and B flat. So he's also using some of the notes that we also had here. So notice that the A is accompanying the E flat. And look at the first interval that he's going to, A and E flat. So it's interesting how the sort of macro level and the micro level can be so combined. It could be completely unconscious, but it still is there. And even if it wasn't conscious, the fact that it's part of Williams's thinking is really extraordinary. This next bit is just a sequence by tone. Like that. So we'll jump up a tone like that, and like that, and each interval becomes an augmented fourth or a diminished fifth, which then gives rise to the other interval again of a diminished fifth, again another diminished fifth. So it's obviously something that he wants to do. Let's just make that a little bit clearer and erase the background at that point. So the next moment is it goes back to this ostinato. Not quite the same. So here we had sort of four-part texture. Here we've just got one part because there's something else going on. And then it's all about thirds. Like that. So we've almost got all of these sort of little, the notes I've circled are basically third relations with two perhaps different sort of octatonic type of things going on here. So if I combine those, it actually combines into an 0-1-3-4, which Williams often uses. And indeed, if you look at the accompaniment here, like that, um, So actually, this this 3-3 set here is actually taken from octatonic T2 as well. So sometimes he combines different octatonic moments, and then also we've also got this tritone. I suppose there's another form of three, isn't it? Three whole tones, I suppose you could argue, which then combine as well, sort of with bass and melody note. Here we get a major third as well, and then a minor third, which is very much part of the major minor effect is very much part of an octatonic type of thing. That sort of thing, that's where it comes from. So then a return to half the tune. So so the three upbeats here, and then it goes into this modular bit. Bum ba ba bum ba ba bum ba ba bum. In this case, it's shortened slightly and goes ba 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 da da dum da da dum da da dum. So a slightly sort of different, slightly varied version of what this was, but basically the same sort of intervals, but then changes right at the end, and then we've got another timpani ba 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 little moment as well, and then an extraordinary sort of moment of what I call a diverging or a divergent progression. So all sorts of things go on. It took me absolutely ages to work out what the earth was going on here, because of course seemingly it's just chords which go up like this, like that, with a wrong note bass. But actually it's even more complicated than that. So let's deal with that first, and then we'll go into why it's more complicated. So we've got triads which have wrong note basses, and this is a particular sort of one, very typical of Williams, how he does this. So, you know, third inversion dominant chord, but notice that there's no G anywhere in the upper extension, so it very much is, you know, A chord but with the wrong note in the bass. In other words, a different note than the one that he has. In this case, it's a sort of third inversion chord, first inversion chord. But now what's happening, we've got a really weird smudge effect. So you've got E flat major with a sharp five, or do we? Because we've also got a C and that with a D as well, with all the notes in between. So we've got a B, we've got a C, we've got a C sharp, we've got a D, and we've got an E flat. Like that. So it's a real smudge. A really interesting sort of smudge. But basically, let's keep it simple with the trumpets and the E flat. So essentially E flat over, sorry, G over an E flat bass. Then we got A major, but with C natural in the bass. Let me just make that even clearer. So that's a little major minor trick that he uses. So this one is a B chord, or you could even call it C flat chord, but with a B flat in it. So two letter names, the same but different, if you see what I mean, different accidentals. So now we've got E flat, but with F sharp in the bass. Again, that major minor feel. So back to the same sort of thing, but this time it's a little bit more obvious. So we got the G here, and then we got the E flat there as well. But except at this point, it's E natural, not E flat, except it is also E flat. So we've got I've got an E flat smudge, because it's both that, which is really interesting. Why did he put an E flat there and not an E? It could just be an error, I'm not sure, but it remained in the recording, so we're going to have to stick with it. So then we've got here the same chord which we had to start off proceedings with, so the A with the G in the bass. This time, B flat with the E. So back to the sharp four idea that we had before. Then just C. Uh, and then it goes all chromatic. Like that, ending on the F7. Like that. And then another interesting chord here, which is an F half dim, but with an extra ninth thrown in there. That sort of chord here, which is always sort of a romantic chord, but it's a really extraordinary thing. So what makes it even more complicated? Well, it's because the entire bass line, pretty much up until there, is all drawn from octatonic T0. So that is an octatonic scale starting on C, which is this. So if you follow all of those notes, you'll see them all there. D sharp is the same as E flat, don't forget. And it sounds a little bit octatonic as well. Same with the top line, but then it changes octatonic transposition, then changes again, then changes again, then changes again, then is chromatic as well. So an extraordinary bit of compositional engineering, let's call it. It really is absolutely unbelievable. And it's just four bars. But the talent that it takes to create those four bars and knowledge is quite extraordinary. And it just happens in a flash. Let's have a look to see whether I can get to that bit. There we go. Absolutely unbelievable. Then, yeah, this sort of half-dim chord with a ninth in it. And then another little lead-in back to the same thing that we had before. So I've just got to that bit, the B-flat minor sharp four with an A in the bass. Again, a B-flat minor with a sharp four, same chord that we had right at the beginning. This time there are more tertial relationships, or relationships of three. So I've highlighted those. Like that, we've got more. And here, like that. That sort of continues. Sometimes it's sort of the same. It's still kind of B-flat minor based, really, because of this happening at the beginning. Let's just go on to that. But it's a bit more obtuse. Okay, and I'm just going to stop it there. But here, this bit here, which is again quite obtuse. If you think about the relationship between D flat and A, it still sounds like a major third, but then we've got this extraordinary chord, which is a 419, so A flat major seventh with a sharp five. So basically A flat augmented chord, but with a seventh on it. Like that. And then another one of those sort of tritone type chords. So this time D flat with a G. So it's not quite the same, but kind of there. And then a... a major minor effect. So the E7 with a B also has G naturals in it as well. So I'm going to actually make those a little bit more obvious if I can. For some reason I can't. There we go. Sometimes Sibelius is very odd in the way that it behaves, but there we go. At least it's quick. So little hints of imperial. And then the same thing that we had before. So in this case, another B flat minor with a sharp four. Let's just look at that carefully. So B flat minor. Yep, with a sharp four. Yes, absolutely. Got it. Another lead in at this point where we have a B flat minor to G major, this sort of tertial shift. So again, note that number three coming back again and again and again. And then we're into one of the most iconic bits of music in the whole of the franchise. So let me just take it back a little bit. There we go, just that page. So I should just add that the A here is also the same type of chord complex 522 that we had. So B flat minor with a sharp four and a major seventh as well. So he's sort of adding. The next bit is the main theme, which reappears. So what's going on? Well, it's harmonized kind of simply, I guess. Look at all of these little add fours or other chords which go on the top of it. Like that. And then when it has the sort of triadic end. Like that is really extraordinary as well. This little chromatic sort of bass line with the triadic bit right at the top. But I just love the fact that this is harmonized correctly. You know, here. Like this with an add nine effect, notice. Like that, right at the end. Then it's slightly varied. So we have this little bit of treading water at this point, where we have, which is quite Walton-esque. I've seen that in Henry V when I was doing the reduction of that. The live performance version of it, which is going to be, I believe, in Berlin next year in 2025. So that's definitely something to look forward to. But a sort of dainty little section. So clarinets and flutes, and then we have more of the same with horns and trumpets. Just trumpets, in fact, because horns are on this line. I was thinking, hold a sec, it sounds like a trumpet, which it is. So the accompaniment is very similar, but as with all of Williams, there's some slight change. So if I play just the theme and the accompaniment, like that. So slightly different. And actually it's quite hard to hear the trombones in that little section. Yeah. So actually quite difficult to hear. I don't know why. miss the end. Just lovely little bit of trombone writing as well. What else is going on? Well, the accompaniment is very similar to the end credits or the opening titles. This the cellos are doing this sort of arpeggiaic effect as well as the bassoons. So basically broken chordal effects, the same thing that the trombones are doing. That's quite common because it's easier. It's quite nice to have that sort of string crossing effect, actually, rather than just playing the same notes. Then we got little bits of filigree, which just fit in around the harmony. So C with a G in the bass. Yep, C major with a G in the bass. D add four sort of thing, but basically it's just D above G. So it's just this sort of, that sort of thing going on. This sort of continually moving type of or shifting harmony with the G in the bass. So we get that again with more tertiary relationships. All major chords. Ah, I can't play it. So yeah. He's just missing the B natural there, the B chord. and then goes back to C minor D, clarinets and flutes. And then we have the second part of Luke's theme, which is, again, with the pedal, which we've seen before. Like that. With slight variation, notice how the trumpets come in with some even more extensions. So seemingly an F chord, but actually it's not, because it's a B flat. So it's a sort of, you know, an 11th chord, really. Like that, and then an A chord above here. So in fact, that's 11. And then D major 9. D major 9, F major 7 with a sharp 5, D7 a bit the 5th. So slight change again. And then if we do the same thing with that other bit of extension. Yeah, and it's actually really discordant that, you know, that that bit here is really extraordinary. It, it just seems to really clash. so yeah, B flat. Yeah, and it's because we're hearing the C. So although, so the orchestrator's being very careful, or Williams being very careful not to have any C there, because there's a C sharp here. So you get a really extraordinary chord. And here, the D7 is with a C natural, but that's still going to ring out the C sharp as well. So it's, sometimes he does really weird things. But it seems to work absolutely fine. And we just don't notice it. Bum, bum, bum. Like that. At all. That's really interesting. It's obviously been changed. Because... like that. And it could just mean being not reading it properly. Yeah, it is. I was just completely wrong. So it's just B flat and D. And then F. And then D. So there we go. Always good to check. Don't know how quite that crept in. I will have to check the full copy of that. It's probably just me being an idiot and not sort of listening to it properly before starting things. So anyway, the next little bit is that the violins go absolutely ballistic at this point. That first bit is really fiddly because you're kind of... are you in third position with the C on the E string? Da da da, playing your one or your first finger on the A. Da 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 da. But then there's a five. There's five, but you've only got four fingers. So you have to shift up somewhere. Da 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 da. But it's a new bow. So do you shift up with your fourth? Da 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 da. And then put your first finger on there up to fifth position. Da 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 da. And then that's with the A string. It's really, really tricky, that little bit at that point, that bar there. And then even this little bit, dee, 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 and then sixth position, da, bum, ba, but that's really awkward as well, with 1-3-4, then shifting back down as well, possibly. I don't think you would want to be on the D string for that. So what works on the piano with five notes does not particularly work with violin because of the fifth. You've only got four fingers to play with, not five. Same with a harp as well. So a really tricky little moment at that point. So then the Glock joins the piano. That's very prominent as this reappears. That sort of B section, the main theme, or the lute's theme, where the woodwind take over as well. But listen to see how hard those violins are playing. Yes, so absolute sort of swashbuckling at this point. It really is Errol Flynn coming out to play. Yes, I mean, even this bit here. Really, really, really tricky little bits. And a sort of interesting little counter melody, because we have the main theme in the woodwind. Like that. It's really, really weird, because the harmony is of E flat, but with that F sharp. So if I just try and play that with the harmony, let's try that. That clash here is absolutely unbelievable. Again, I'm just going to double check it that I haven't just made a horrible error, but let's have a look. Oh, it's there. And I've never noticed that before. It's one of those things where only by sort of forensically analysing this thing can you kind of make out what is going on. Really, really extraordinary. E flat with a sharp 9. Ooh, I mean, you know, really extraordinary. Something's not quite right there. You know, it's like, oh, this is a bit daring. Interesting how he does that. Really, really extraordinary. And then we have a normal sort of rising bass. Almost sort of like, that Cockney intros. That comedian does, which is just fantastic. Yes, and then triadic planing, which carries on. That's how we can. Absolutely extraordinary, that whole section. I could listen to it again and again and again. It really is absolute swashbuckling stuff. So after this sort of planing rise, triadic planing, we've then got a really interesting bit, which is all sort of free invention. This sort of figuration is something that Williams uses quite a lot. It is quite pianistic, having those, that sort of fifth. And interestingly, here it's slightly different, the notes. So here there's a B in this bit, but there's an A. Sorry, that should have been a B. Here. So slightly different But basically all of those notes, and of course you can see the harps all glissing in opposite directions. So we're in F major, and I've just called it F diatonic because there's no, I'm not sure what to call that chord. It's just sort of, you know, F added with a sharp four, or you could call it sharp 11 with a ninth as well, but no seventh. Although there is actually is a major seventh as well. So all the notes apart from that note. So F diatonic, I think, is a sort of adequate response to that. And then we've got the trombones, which play the main theme or Luke's theme as well. Again, this little chromatic rise, which happens actually quite discordantly, but it's so quick, which you don't really realise it. You know, very popular to have sometimes pizzicato or sort of glock or piano doing this sort of thing, just reiterating each of those notes. Similar thing happens here with the woodwind coming in. And this little bit here is really extraordinary. So he starts off with an F with an E in the bass, and then goes to a B flat 7, which is a sort of very, very quick way of getting to E flat. So it's really extraordinary. And all of these notes are just filling in the scale harmony of whatever this is doing. So if we think of F major and then B flat and then, but in the space of three beats, it's a really extraordinary achievement to go from F to E flat. Whoops. So F major. Yeah, that modulation is absolutely unbelievable. It is absolutely incredible. You know, F major. So it ending up on the dominant of F, but now it changes. So it's this sort of, you know, it could go anywhere. That dyad is the key to it. And he does that, is what you really want, but he goes. So the real secret of this is that he flattens the A there. And that is how he achieves it. It's really extraordinary. So from F. But he doesn't end on an E-flat pedal note. He ends on a second inversion chord, which is so often the case. So when he changes key, often that first chord is a second inversion, not a root position chord. So scale, which follow those, and then second inversion chord. Let's try and listen to it once more. Yeah, and a real sort of three bars of romance, and then it's all over. Back into swashbuckling stuff. It's like, oh, hello. Had no sort of reaction to you before, but now, yeah, let's get going. Partly, you know, poor old Williams didn't realise, and he wasn't told that they were going to be twins, and I think it was changed for the second film. So that sort of bitter blossoming romance happens very briefly for three bars. And then he had to invent a whole new theme for the Han and Leia one. So this chord here, which is... So that F half dim, which is all over the place. So all of those chords are just playing the same chord, but just broken up. So it sounds rather sloshy and romantic, especially those cello triplets. Yeah, an amazing sort of bit of cello, giving the line to the harp and the clarinet at that point. So here, like that, really extraordinary. And then the real sort of heroic this sort of fanfare, especially with the bass. Like that, and eventually it gets to a sort of basically a B flat, really. Is it A flat with a B flat at the bass? I'm not sure that it really is. But basically, I've just called it a smudge. It's really a sort of B flat with a suspended harmony, isn't it? So it's a sort of dominant chord. Let's see what does it give me another option of B flat. No, it does everything apart from the chord that I need it to do, which is really, really silly. So let's see whether we can actually try and do this. So I think part of the problem is that we kind of do have the D there, because it's there. So we've got B flat. So I don't need the fifth. So we've got B flat 7. So C would be adding a ninth. We don't have that. But we do have the 11th and 13th. So it's sort of B flat 13. Let's just call it that. But slightly smudged. But basically it's a big dominant, bom, bom, into E flat. But notice again, there's no sort of resolution of tonic at that point. It's another second inversion. So incredibly complex as well, just those three bars. Yeah, and a wonderful sort of almost sort of part of Leia, you know, hints of the end credits, and really sort of slushy harmony at that point. So very slowly, have to put my octave transition on. So A half dim. And it wants to go to E flat, but it's just interrupted, where we get another version, but this time it's exactly the same chords. This time C minor sharp 4 over B. And for some reason that hadn't had colorization. And then we're back into imperials. So I should probably just put a little yellow marker on that at that point. Always something that perhaps doesn't get put in, so I'm going to go ostinato. Whoops. Imperial. Imperials. Whoops. Trying to do it small type, but there we go. So very, very subtle change, And then we get into this sort of sudden dyad section. Yeah, I'm definitely sure there's an extra piano added to that harp part there on the recording. I'm just going to listen to that again. And here we get augmented chords with C's, same augmented chord with an A flat. So dyad. Back to that tritone. Now sad Luke. A half dim with an 11th. Ah, that's interesting. They changed it. So that seems to be two C's. So that's changed. So I'm going to have to make a note of that. 1-3-1. Yeah. Interesting that he chose to have a C then instead of D there. I don't know whether that's just an error in the performance, but either way, it is definitely on the recording. Then again, B minor with a sharp 4 B flat. So again, the same sort of type of bass, this time with added woodwind accompaniments as well. Notice that little 3/8 bar, obviously to do with the synchronization aspects of what we've got going on. And then there we go. So so here we've got B minor, but then imperials in D as well. So slightly different. So, yeah, we've got a real sense of that. Just check that note, actually. Should it be a G? No. Yeah, really weird chord. Yeah, so that chord here is really extraordinary. It sounds like kind of sort of that, so it's still sort of B flat Hungarian minor with a sharp 4, but it's not quite, because we've got here, but then we've got A minor in the timps, and then, you know, the flutes sort of do that as well. But if you put all of those notes together, we get another of those 3/3 type effects right at the end. A really extraordinary sort of little bit that we have before. By the way, I should have pointed out that we've also got sort of vibraphone coming in before as well, which also gives it that sort of rather space-like effect as well, which is really interesting. So yeah, how to end it. Here we go. Close the blast doors. Open the blast doors. Yeah, definitely with a vibe as well. Again, I'll have to check that with the orchestration. I'm not sure that was put in the original, where it was added right in the session, but definitely it adds that sort of slightly space-like theremin type sound right at the end, sort of a pure sound with a vibraphone but without having to use the theremin. So a phenomenal cue with so much in it, and I still don't even feel as though I've done it justice spending 47 minutes on it, but you know, it's definitely something that you could study for a long, long time. I've just sort of, in a sense, just given you an overview of what things to look out for with all of it. But you know, this section here, which we've listened to a number of times now, and it's interesting, the more I listen to it, the more I sort of think, ah, yeah, okay, that's it. I can see Yeah, I can kind of see where I can almost reach what Williams is doing at that point. Sort of just about after 3.5 years of studying Williams, I can just about get to grips with how it all works. you could do an entire degree program only devoted to just the Star Wars music of Williams. I mean, I haven't looked at anything else. It's only been this. So I don't know whether he does this in every film, but no doubt people who have lots of listening in their experience will no doubt know. But it's an extraordinary achievement. I mean, it really is. And the more I look at it, the more you realise how much of an absolute master he is at his craft. Absolutely incredible. And to come up with all those themes is just unbelievable. So I hope I've added to the sort of discourse on this. And I really, really hope that you've enjoyed me bringing this to you and sort of breaking it down into hopefully small bite-sized pieces. But that is it for now, folks. And I really look forward to bringing you the next few cues, which is really the whole denouement of the film. It really hots up at this point now on. So lots and lots more to look forward to. See you next time.